So welcome to lecture 32. In this lecture now we will see how to derive FEM formulation for permanent magnets. We start with this governing equation which we have seen in the previous lecture, right. So J is basically due to free current and this is representing the source corresponding to permanent magnet, right. And now henceforth subscript r will be dropped. So this actually you have to always remember, this all m henceforth actually is mr, right. So subscript r for m is dropped for simplicity. So now what we will do is we will apply weighted residual method to above formulation, right. So in residual weighted residual method what we do, we integrate the weight into residue over the domain
and equate it to 0,
is it not? And here, and why there is residue, because we generally have, we substitute approximate solution, so there will be residue and we minimize the residue in weighted integral sense, right. Now as compared to earlier approach that we saw, weighted residual, there is one difference here. Now here we, there it was a purely scalar formulation because we had seen two dimensional formulation with A in current in Z direction, so A in Z direction. So it was only, you know, direction was fixed, only magnitude was to be determined, right. But here now in general, because M is vector, so we have to work in vector notation, right. So that is why this weight also becomes vector, because residue will be vector. So will be the, you know, weight has to be vector, okay. What does it mean? We will see as we go along. So now we have here again Galerkin's approach. There also we took weighting function as shape function, only difference being here it is now vector, is capital bold W and bold Ni, okay. So now this is this term we are first taking. So this term we are actually we are using this vector identity. B is this term and C is Ni, right. So using this vector identity, this expression is split into two, right. You can verify, it comes very well this. So now we consider this second term first. This actually we apply divergence theorem, we have seen this earlier, right. Actually here divergence theorem, divergence of vector dv, is it not, integral, is equal to that vector dot ds. But now since it is 2D approximation, dv becomes dx dy and ds becomes an dl, same thing we had done earlier, right. And now this actually, this whole thing is a vector because this is going to be a vector, that vector
multiplied with
the normal vector to that surface, because this is actually surface, is it not, but in two dimension it becomes an dl contour, okay. So this
multiplied with
an will result in normal component to that surface, okay. And if there is homogeneous Neumann condition, then this whole thing will become 0, is it not. If it is not, then of course this will result into some term and then our final FEM matrix equation will have additional term. It is not that always, you know, you have to have this condition, it is not like that. If it is homogeneous Neumann condition is there, that means derivative of field with respect to the normal direction, if it is 0, then it simply, this simplifies to 0, is it not, because this results into normal derivative. If there is no this condition getting satisfied, this will not be 0 and there will be additional term in our final matrix equation, that is the only thing, right? And remember this, this is if we are at the element level, if you remember this, all at all elements is internal contribution, common contributions will get cancelled because n vectors will be opposite. You remember that? And only on the outside boundary this will get executed when you when we assemble all the elements, right? So that's why when I say homogeneous Neumann condition, this is on the outermost boundary, because inner inter element segments the ends are being opposite, and that's why those contributions will get cancelled. So same theory as we have seen earlier. So this is applicable only the boundary condition on the outermost boundary, right? So now then one term goes to zero. So this term goes to zero if there is a homogeneous Neumann condition on the outermost boundary everywhere, right? So now we are left with this term and then this term, is it not? Because we had split this term into two, and out of this one is made zero. So then we are left with this term and this term, okay? That's what is being written here, two terms, okay? Now we will go further. Now this expression is split into two now, del cross A dot this, and then this term dot again del cross Ni, right? So this is split into two and this as it is. Now we know del cross A with two dimensional formulation, with A being only in AZ direction, right? It becomes this you have seen earlier. Similarly, del cross Ni being in again Z direction, so this is actually Ni subscript Z, because if A is in Z direction, Ni also will be in Z direction, because finally what is Ni? Because A magnetic vector potential for any element is A is equal to n1 a1 plus n2 a2 plus n3 a3. So in this vector formulation, the direction to A will be given by direction of n's, because a1 a2 a3 are just scalars at the nodes, three nodes. Are you getting what I am saying? A is equal to n1 a1 plus n2 a2 plus n3 a3, is it not? Now A on this left hand side is vector, so on the right hand side also there has to be vector, but a1 a2 a3 they are just the scalar magnitude. So here A being vector, it gets reflected by n1 n2 n3 being vectors, right? And if A is in Z direction, n1 n2 n3 also will be in Z direction, is it not? If A has only Z component, n1 n2 n3 also will have Z component only, right? So that is the reason that here that's why Ni, actually here it is Niz, but I have dropped that subscript Z for simplicity, right? So it is Niz, okay? Then again, like del cross A is this, del cross Ni also will be this, is it not? Same thing, only just replaced AZ by Ni, remember it is Niz. Now what we want here is del cross A dot del cross Ni. So del cross A is this, del cross Ni is this, and then this gets simplified to this, right? So just a dot product, and that is why then you get, now this A is, when it is replaced by this, is it not, then this AJ will come out, and then this A you will have Ni here, is it not? When A is replaced by this, summation Ni AI, J goes from 1 to 3, is it clear? When this now A is replaced by this, you will get AJ out, and summation, is it not? And then you will get this just a product of this and product of this two. At node 1, for example, N2 and N3 are 0, right? Then N1 has to be, because this is now A equal to A is in Z direction, N1 has to be in Z direction. In fact, this N is our standard N, right? Yeah, so earlier also this N, this was in Z direction because A was in Z direction, is it not? It was a 2D formulation, A was in Z direction, is it not? So Ni there also was in Z. So there also it was a function of X and Y, and it was in Z direction because A is in Z direction there also. But here we are doing vectorial because M generally will be in two, because M will have two components X and Y, as we will see earlier. No, because that question arises because we have here M. M is generally in say X and Y directions. Generally, you know, this permanent magnet, M we know this is in this direction, is it not? This is the XY plane. M is in, it can be, you know, either this is XY plane, so it can have in general X and Y depending upon the orientation of this permanent magnet. Suppose the permanent magnet is like this vertical, it will have only Y component. If it is, you know, at an angle, it will have both X and Y components, is it not? And earlier in our 2D formulation, everything, you know, current as well as A, they were in Z direction and there was no other vector there. So, you know, we were always solving in terms of A.
With scalar formulation.
And then there was no other vector wherein we had to take cross product or whatever, okay. Then this gets simplified to, now we are in position to write, because now we have this N del cross Ni, we have this, is it not? So this M is nothing but with X and Y components, and del cross Ni is this, del cross Ni, right? Same del cross n I here, and then we just sort of simplify this dot product, so you get this term, this into this and this into this with a minus sign here. Now we take you know these derivatives, right? We take derivatives and then we get where n i is this, right? So then we get standard derivative with respect to y will result only in qi, derivative with respect to x will result into pi only. So that's our standard thing. So that's why here finally at the element level, now remember this is qi and pi, this we are doing weighted residual. So this statement that we have got, this will be for one node. Similarly, there will be, you will get two equations for other two nodes, right? So that's why you will get three equations. That's why, you know, I was telling here this is, you know, Ni, so this also really is Ni, because we are talking weighted residual statement is for each node, right? So that's the reason when you write weighted residual statement for other two nodes also, suppose this we have done for I, suppose there is J and K, then we'll get
additional
two such statements, and that is the reason your final matrix equation at the element level will be q1, q2, q3, because here you will get q1, and if this is say node 1, you would have got q1 and p1, q2, p2, q3, p3, right? So this whole thing is leading to only this matrix. This anyway is going to come from this. This is going to give you your C matrix, is it not? So this is going to give you C matrix. This is that individual matrix, is it not? L3, this will give you 3x3 matrix for the element, right? And then into AJ is coming here. This BE is our standard matrix which will come out of the source condition. If there is a J also, then this will be like J delta by 3, and then the corresponding B matrix will get formed. And when you combine all this, at the end, if there is a non-zero, non-homogeneous condition, then that term also will come on account of boundary. Or if there is a outermost boundary with A equal to 0 or some Dirichlet condition, then that has to be imposed at the final global system of equations. Okay. So, what was new in this permanent magnet FEM formulation? Only this term, and that is what we have seen, the complete derivation of that. Yeah, it was there in our previous formulation also, it was there. Because no, the, it is not new, it is only mx into this, mx and my have come now, na? And then this this term also, this multiplicand, that was all not there. This in fact whole term itself was not there, because now there are mx and my, this whole term has have come. So if suppose now you see, if there is no permanent magnet, mx and my are 0, this whole term becomes 0 and you get only the Poisson's equation without permanent magnet, which will be, you know, del square A equal to minus mu j. That is our this, at the element level that will be the equation, is it not? So this actually term is coming at the element level only on account of presence of permanent magnet. Okay, now quickly we will see the Scilab code. If suppose you were to develop, then what will be the change? The change will be only to the extent of this term only, is it not? That is all, rest everything is same. So here, you know, again wherever permanent magnet is there, we have to basically note that. So go from 1 to number of elements, and here that permanent magnet is subdomain number 5. Because T first, you know, entry of the T matrix is the subdomain number. So we are assuming here that permanent magnet is subdomain number 5, right? And then the corresponding, let us, we have assumed that M is only in y direction. So it is a vertically placed magnet. So My, and M value is this, right? 1.14 into 10 raised to 6. Now this, you know, is quite high as compared to non-magnetic materials. This is very high, right? So that's why it is a permanent magnet. So My is high. So remember, for ferromagnetic material also, this will be high. M will be high. That capital M. Now this is Mr actually. Are you getting? This is actually Mr. Then going further, then this element level coefficient matrix is the exactly identical equation 112C33 is the same expression. The change only is in this B. No, it is minus 0.5 my P1, P2, P3, because these are that additional term. Here mx is equal to 0, mx is 0 because magnet is in vertical direction. So this reduces to only y component, right? And that is what is minus 0.5 my P1, P2, P3, because it is element level, it will be 3 entries will be there, right? And here mx is 0 anyway. And I am assuming mu r for that permanent magnet as being equal to 1, right? That is why nu is reflectivity is 1 over mu, which is equal to mu 0 times mu r. But mu r I am assuming equal to 1, that means chi m I am assuming as equal to 0, right? And that is the reason that this becomes just 1 over mu 0, and then that gets cancelled with this. So that is why only minus 0.5 remains, and then that is the then you get this. Okay, so that is the only change here, rest all the code remains same.